decided to talk this afternoon about Persier antiquity, and that quite challenging because one of the main goals of the exhibition was to show how the interest of Persier extends much beyond antique model, which is obviously famous to be, and that obviously remains clearly his main interest and his main focus, just before Italian architecture. But, obviously the theme of Persian antiquity will help me to go through this question, to show how his references and his work extend much beyond than the antique model. And I will try to do that in two ways. One is to talk about, you know, the various different aspects of architecture, sculpture that he studied, but also the way he studied these different aspects. So, for me, Persier, beyond the antique model, means in one way what Persier observes beyond the antique references, what he will represent, study, what historical periods or what production he studied, but also how his approach changes as compared with what was done by some of his contemporary or the architects working or studying in the years before. So, my microphone just changed. So, if we want to illustrate how wide his interest is beyond the antique models, we can start with the Palais et Maison et autres édifices modernes dessinés à Rome, which I studied extensively. As you know, a young architect in Rome, in the French Academy, were supposed to study Roman buildings, so antique buildings, and they do so from the opening of the French Academy in Rome in the second half of the 17th century. But, besides this official study of antiquity, obviously they observe the architecture built from the Renaissance period, the Baroque period, and even from the Middle Ages, and little by little, some of these architects produces drawing, study on this architecture. But Persier and Fontaine were the first to publish in 1798 a book dedicated to this modern architecture, which means clearly at that period not antique architecture. I mean, the only definition you can give for modern in this title is not antique. And they were the first to publish a book who gives modern Italian building model to the French architect to design new projects. And without surprise, the book is dedicated to Roman houses and palaces like this one that may be considered as models for the production of the new houses or buildings in the Paris of the end of the 18th century, beginning of the 19th century. The most important Roman buildings are represented, like the Palais Farnese, here, studied in a quite classical way. You see a study of the two lower levels of the courtyard, plus details of the cornice and the order. And this, you know, interest for Renaissance period, you can find elsewhere. Anywhere else in the production, drawn production by Persier, like for example here in this drawing of Palazzo Te at Mantua, visited in 1791 during his trip back from Rome to France. In one way, we can assume this is still an interest for antiquity. the reason for this paradox point of view is that the architecture of the houses, the architecture of the palace, could substitute a knowledge that had disappeared about private Roman architecture at that time. And the architect of the Renaissance period could be considered as the producers that give us an idea of what should have been this Roman building if they still exist. So studying these houses and this is some kind of a continuity of the study on antique Roman architecture. Also, this continuity is also a way to, I mean, to move away from the center of this antique model. And I mean, as you go away, you arrive to examples that begin to be autonomous from the antiquity, like these drawings made at Fontainebleau, the Porte Dorée, were very close from the previous ones, but made probably a few weeks after, when before entering Paris, made a last stop to study Fontainebleau, where his professor Antoine-François Père was living. And you see that little by little, this interest center on antiquity opens towards other references, in this case, French reference, French Renaissance, and ornament at Fontainebleau. But the same book is also open to medieval examples, like in the case of churches, because for the religious architecture, the interest by Percier and Fontaine was to find an alternative model to the Manierist and Baroque Roman architecture. And this alternative model was researched in what was considered in one way as the last legacy in terms of religious architecture of the antiquity. So the basilica of the beginning of the Christianism, buildings from, let's say, the 4th century, and buildings realized all along the Middle Ages are present in the book, which opens the references to the medieval period. Also, this too was conceived as an extension of antiquity, but clearly, from various points of view, it opens also to an interest much wider than the interest focused on antiquity and what we call neoclassicism. In the same book, and in another way, this is also medieval architecture, you find a few elements who open the interest of Percier, or enlarge the interest of Percier towards a picturesque approach. This is the case of this perspective on the left of the a view of the outside of Sistine Chapel in the Vatican. You see a photograph from the mid-19th century of the building. This helps us to think about another dimension of that. The way, you know, an approach which is not classically architectural in the way there are no plans, sections, elevation of that, but only picturesque view, perspective helps to consider buildings that would not have been considered using the more classical tools of representation of the architect. So, and this is, according to me, very important, the way to represent this building like a landscape or like a picturesque composition and not really like an architecture helps to enlarge the references to other irregular, imperfect, and anyway not classical models. And when you look through the drawings produced by Percier and in the collection of the Institut de France, you see that there are many attempts to catch another, let's say, beauty, another form of beauty, another aesthetic in this particular case, you see that nothing in this architecture is regular, is antique, is classical. But Percier observed that, the volumes, the shadows, and tried to catch another kind of interest in these examples. Another and last representation of the same building, who shows how two representation like informal sketches or perspective composition helps to enlarge and widen his point of view towards different architecture. Well, we can come back a few minutes to the way architects were studying in Rome in the same year. The year before Charles Percier was awarded Rome Prize, Jacques Guillaume Legrand and Jacques Molinos traveled to Italy, and they visited a lot of antique buildings, with in the end a copy of Dégodé's Edifice Antique de Rome, first published in 1682, and they made a lot of observation in order to correct, to comment, to complete this classical study of classical buildings. And it's very interesting to see, which the year before Percier arrives in Italy, how these two very important neoclassical French architects, study the continuity, the Roman antiques in the continuity with the practice of the previous decades, of the previous century. One century ago, Dégodé was in Italy, and they are in Italy just to check the measure, to add some information, but we are working in the same, in a continuity with Dégodé. So you see that representation is very precise, quite schematic is the expression, with measure of details, and on the other hand, the manuscript opens its point of view to some different kind of object, some different kind of observation. You see here some fragments at the Colosseum, represented, but not very in a very picturesque way. Although there are some vegetation represented around the sculpture, who shows in one way a first interest for something more picturesque, but the representation itself remains much more schematic than what we will find with Percier 1 or 2 years after. So here, for example, a bas-relief represented near the Campidoglio by Percier. You see the interest is more or less for the same kind of production, but the way it is studied is much different, because Percier really wanted to catch some kind of an aesthetic, a sensibility. So his will is to study antiquity in order to develop his own skill, more than to measure precisely the proportion, the size of every element. And this is true, for example, for this beautiful head of lions that recalls the head of lions used in one of the armchairs presented in the exhibition. Percier really tried to produce this beautiful drawing, not with the purpose of producing beautiful drawing, but because it's some kind of a way to catch what is interesting in the pieces he study, is to be able to translate part of the beauty of this example in the beauty of his drawing. And you feel that the measures, the detail, sometimes he measures some details, but it's not so important. It's not the producing schematic drawings is not his main interest. His main interest is producing drawings that catch the beauty of the things that he represents, and for this reason we can say that he is really in the mood of being an architect artist. Beautiful drawing of a country suite. example here, a very sketchy representation of fragments, which according to my opinion is extremely interesting because, you know, it shows Percier in a very sketchy drawing, instead of representing one fragment or one element, combining various elements in a freestyle combination. And you know, this probably could be maybe compared with what is the most stable representation of classical imitation of antiquity. If we take here this very famous engraving by Charles Perrault, Ordonnance des cinq espèces de colonnes, which put together represents something like the antiquity put it in order and organized according to something very regular, very precise, and very ordered. You have on the other hand Percier and his proposal to present more or less the same legacy, but to present it in an artistic free way of composition, and based on the same antique corpus of fragments, elements of architecture, you can probably, if you want to, build some kind of an opposition between the new way to look at antiquity by Percier and the way it was looked at by his predecessor, you can maybe oppose these two images. As you saw in the exhibition, this way to combine fragments and elements is not only a way to present the element, but also some kind of a research tool that helps to synthesize a knowledge at certain moments. You see here a huge composition of fragments. There is another one in the exhibition. And if you look at the details, you see that once again, all these pieces of antiquity are recomposed, reordered to form a new knowledge and a new organization, which is based on a very artistic and, let's say, subjective approach. These compositions of fragments used on the spot by Percier, as we saw first, used for a big painting to be presented in the salon, as we saw just before, and used for the frontispiece of the group dedicated to the Patron, as in the image on the left, was also a tool that could be used to design architectural spaces, as we see in this design for Maison Romaine. So here the antique model is used in a non-conventional way, in a non-classical way, to combine and to propose. You probably see that the two images has a lot in common in terms of composition, with the various successive grounds of the perspective, with the diagonal also of the organization from the top left to the right down. And you see how it can skip from composition of fragment to a real architectural space at a different scale. But it's also an interest for non-conventional, not very classical antique elements of architecture, who opens the way to Percier designing, creating, inventing new shapes, like this beautiful sketch for a capital inside the cabinet de Platine at Alain-Croisse. So, this central part of his investigation around graphic art obviously include an interest for antiquity, as we can see here in the illustration of the two works of Ores, but it also opened towards, as presented in the exhibition, interest for other historical periods, like French 17th century. You see, even in the same book, to neo-oriental architecture atmosphere, we are in 1802, which is quite early in France for such productions. And if you go further, this interest for architecture and models beyond the classical models taken in the French Renaissance or even Middle Ages helped Percier to propose to us compositions which are not neoclassical anymore, as in the 1820s. You see these two compositions of frontispiece or SPCs or book. In the description du Musée des Monuments Français by Alexandre Lenoir, the tool, let's say, of composition of fragments, this tool of, let's say, frontispiece is used in order to compose something around Écouen, a French Renaissance building, with pieces at various different scales and assembled in order to create this synthetic image called Details of Architecture of the Beautiful Palace of Écouen. So the interest by Percier for the French Renaissance is simply beyond a classical model and classical architecture. For although he remarks that this architecture is imperfect and irregular in its overall shape, it has, as he said, very beautiful and outstanding details, and that's the most important for him. Well, this work with Alexandre Lenoir leads Percier to draw very early at the Abbey of Saint-Denis. He draws here the Abbey of Saint-Denis before the main revolutionary destruction. This drawing are very important now in Compiègne. And well, we could finish this presentation showing that this interest for medieval French architecture helps him to create very syncretic composition as this one for the ephemeral entrance of Notre Dame de Paris for the coronation of Napoleon in 1804, where you see an architect interested by antiquity as his main model and by Italy producing a neo-Gothic French architecture based on his curiosity and eclectic interest that leads him very far beyond the antique model. Iris Moon, which is a distinguished professor in the School of Architecture at Pratt Institute, specialized in 18th and 19th century French art, architecture, and decorative arts. She earned a PhD from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology and has held fellowship at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, the Clark Institute, and the Getty Research Institute. The book, The Architecture of Percy and Fontaine and the Struggle for Sovereignty in Revolutionary France, will be published this November with the French Press. She gives today a talk, called New Heads for Old Bodies, Percy's Design for the French Revolution.